morning. We're going to start gathering in for worship. Happy Mother's Day to all mothers and to all women who are like mothers and are mothers to all of us. We thank you for everything you do. And as a thank you, we have roses in the back, so please pick a rose on the way out. Usually someone in my family reminds us that the women get flowers and the men get chocolates for Father's Day. Yeah, where's the chocolate for women? So happy Mother's Day. Today marks a baby bottle drive, and there's an insert in your bulletin. The CARE Pregnancy Center has a baby bottle drive. And so the way we're going to do it is there are baby bottles in the back and there's baby bottles on the side. Grab one, take it home, and we're going to bring them back on Father's Day. So it's pretty easy to remember. Take it home on Mother's Day, bring it back on Father's Day, and then we'll drop it off. That way you can just have it out on a counter and fill it over the next month. So that goes to CARE Pregnancy Center. Lots of announcements in your bulletins, so take a moment and a little bit to read through. Let's pray. Gracious Almighty God, we are so, so thankful to be in your house today. We are so thankful for the example that you have given us in your word of love and of sacrifice, of grace and of mercy. And Lord, today as we come before your throne, we come with all of our needs, all of our desires given over to you, Father. We pray that this time be a time not just of peace, but of conviction. Allow us to separate for just a little bit from the world so that we can hear you. Lord, we pray for you to speak to us, speak through us, so when we leave here in just a little bit, we are more peaceful, we are more gentle, we're more aware of your impact on our lives, we pray. Amen.
Grace and peace be with you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. The Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Please rise and open your hymn books to hymn number 43, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul.
God guides me along the right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will try.
Trust in you, Lord.
like we're a quiet luncheon here today.
Join together in prayer. Oh Lord God, we have sung praise. You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of all that we can give to you. Lord, thank you that you call us by name. You know us. That you take ownership of us. That we are your sheep, the people of your pasture, Lord. Thank you that you just love us and see us through so many tough times that we're in. That you don't give up on us. You keep working. Lord, we offer praise and thanks to you for this great love. Continue to speak and mold us and make us into the people that you desire us to be. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. I'll ask the ushers to gather and that we would receive our mornings and tithes and offerings at this time.
reading from 2 Samuel 13, verses 15 through 39. Then Amnon hated Tamar with intense hatred. In fact, he hated her more than he had loved her. Amnon said to her, "Get up and get out." "No," she said to him, "sending me away would be a greater wrong than what you have already done to me." But he refused to listen to her. He called his personal servant and said, "Get this woman out of my sight and bolt the door after her." So his servant put her out and bolted the door after her. She was wearing an ornate robe, for this was the kind of garment the virgin daughters of the king wore. Tamar put ashes on her head and tore the ornate robe she was wearing. She put her hands on her head and went away, weeping out loud as she went. Her brother Absalom said to her, "Has that Amnon, your brother, been with you? Be quiet for now, my sister. He is your brother. Don't take this thing to heart." And Tamar lived in her brother Absalom's house, a desolate woman. When King David heard all this, he was furious, and Absalom never said a word to Amnon, either good or bad. He hated Amnon because he had disgraced his sister Tamar. 2 years later, when Absalom's sheep shearers were at Baal Hazor, near the border of Ephraim, he invited all the king's sons to come there. Absalom went to the king and said, "Your servant has had shearers come. Will the king and his attendants please join me?" "No, my son," the king replied. "All of us should not go. We would only be a burden to you." Although Absalom urged him, he still refused to go, but gave him his blessing. Then Absalom said, "If not, please let my brother Amnon come with us." The king asked him, "Why should he go with you?" But Absalom urged him, so he sent with him Amnon and the rest of the king's sons. Absalom ordered his men, "Listen. When Amnon is in high spirits from drinking wine, and I say to you, strike Amnon down, then kill him. Don't be afraid. Haven't I given you this order? Be strong and brave." So Absalom's men did go to Amnon, what Absalom had ordered. Then all the king's sons got up, mounted their mules, and fled. While they were on their way, the report came to David. "Absalom has struck down all the king's sons. Not one of them is left." The king stood up, tore his clothes, and lay down on the ground, and all his attendants stood by with their clothes torn. But Jonadab, son of Shimei, David's brother, said, "My lord should not think that they killed all the princes. Only Amnon is dead. This has been Absalom's express intent ever since the day Amnon raped his sister Tamar. My lord the king should not be concerned about the report that all the king's sons are dead. Only Amnon is dead." Meanwhile, Absalom had fled. Now the men standing watch looked up and saw many people on the road west of him coming down the side of the hill. The watchmen went and told the king, "I see men in the direction of Horonaim on the side of the hill." Jonadab said to the king, "See, the king's sons have come. It has happened just as your servant said." As he finished speaking, the king's sons came in, wailing loudly. The king, too, and all his attendants wept very bitterly. Absalom fled and went to Talmai, son of Ammihud, the king of Geshur. But King David mourned many days for his son. After Absalom fled and went to Geshur, he stayed there 3 years. And King David longed to go to Absalom, for he was consoled concerning Amnon's death.
So if you're joining us for the first time, we've been in a series on 2 Samuel. You've heard the bulk of chapter 13, but we're going to focus on verses 1 through 22 today for the service, and we're going to skip around and use some gentle language because we have children in our service. But let's pray. Gracious Almighty God, we thank you for what you've done, for allowing us to have a record of your word, a record that is not of perfected people, but of people who are broken, people who have been changed by you. Lord, allow us to learn from your story today, we pray. Amen. So last week when we left here, we left with David having received his consequences for his sin after his affair with Bathsheba. And one of the consequences for his sin was that the sword would never leave his house. Yolam is never in Hebrew. It means antiquity, forever and ever, for future generations. It meant that David's children and David's grandchildren would suffer the effect of the consequences of his sin. If you're anything like me, you read that and you think, holy cow, how do you get this to stop? How do you get this to stop? How do we live with that? I mean, is there a difference between consequences and the effect of consequences? Are we destined as children and grandchildren of parents who made mistakes to continue making those mistakes? My parents are divorced. Am I destined to be divorced because they're divorced? Effects of sin, the consequences of sin, are actually two different things. So David has before him the consequences of his sin. What his children have are the effects of the consequences of the sin. My parents are divorced, and so I feel the effect of that in my life as their children. But does it mean that I have to assume that same baggage? Do I have to be suspect of intimacy and trust and fidelity? David's children are going to feel the effect of his sin, but does that mean that their life has to be derailed because of that? And how do you stop this systemic cycle of sin and effect and consequences into second and third and fourth generations in family? Is there a way to break that cycle? Is sin a choice? Is it a learned behavior? Is it a reflex from one generation to the next? Are we doomed to carry out the same mistakes? And what if forever, because of trauma, our genes are altered to bear the scars of that trauma? I mean, how do you live your life and not overcompensate for what's happened to you? Sometimes trauma makes its mark on our very genes. And that happened in the Netherlands in 1944 and 1945. In the throes of one of the most difficult parts of World War II, in the Netherlands from 1944 to 1945, they suffered a drought of malnourishment and nutrition. They ran out of supplies. And because of the war, supplies couldn't get to them. And even when supplies could get to them, because fighting lifted, there were areas that were frozen and they couldn't access. As a result, in 1944 to 1945, an entire generation of adults faced starvation. Thousands and thousands of people died. At the height of the malnourishment, people were existing on 400 calories a day. That's about 3 potatoes. When it got even worse than that, vegetable peels were consumed. And when the vegetable peels were consumed, they ate dirt and grass. As a result, that entire generation that survived, those who lived to tell about what is known as hunger winter, had forever had chronic health issues. Think Audrey Hepburn. She was one who survived. She was waif thin her entire life. So the next generation, people assumed, would have the same chronic illness, a mark of that malnutrition. And they assumed, particularly the babies that were in utero at the time of the height of the malnourishment, would have that same condition of being waif-like. But in the 1980s, what emerged were the children of the survivors who weren't waif-like. They actually had high rates of obesity and metabolic disarray. That's because when babies in utero are starved, their metabolic system actually changes to compensate for caloric reduction, and they hoard on weight so that it paradoxically creates increased metabolic disarray, and increased levels of obesity and heart disease. And that's what happened to these children of the survivors in the 1980s. But not just the children. In the 1990s, they discovered that it was the grandchildren that had the same condition. High rates of heart disease, high rates of obesity. And what was shocking to scientists was that they assumed the starvation would bear its mark on the genes of those who survived it, but it changed the genes of those who came after. And in his book, The Gene, I want to read to you, the author describes it as this, what happens after. He says, the acute starvation of men and women during those brutal months in 1945 indubitably altered the expression of genes involved in metabolism and storage. The first changes were transient, no more perhaps than turning on and turning off of genes that respond to nutrients in the environment. But as the landscape of metabolism was frozen and reset by prolonged starvation, as transience hardened into permanence, more durable changes were imprinted in the genome. Hormones fanned out between organs, signaling the potential long-term deprivation of food and auguring a broader reformatting of gene expression. Proteins intercepted these messages within cells. Genes were shut down one by one. Then imprints were stamped on DNA to close them down further, like houses shuttering against a storm. Entire gene programs were barricaded shut. Methylation marks were added to genes. Histones may have been chemically modified to record the memory of starvation. Cell by cell, organ by organ, the body was reprogrammed for survival. That's exactly what happens in David's family. Organ by organ, cell by cell, they have been reprogrammed for survival. And so it's tempting to almost feel, that what comes next after that level of survival is falling back into the tendencies of the father. And I say almost feel, because sin is a choice. Sin is not a reflex, it is a choice that we make. If we're not going to repeat the mistakes our parents made, the mistakes our grandparents made, then we have to have a force acting on our body, much like the trauma and hunger winter acted on the gene. What if it's possible to have environmental actions and environmental situations act upon us in a way that doesn't make us fall suit into what was, but actually writes a new code above our genes? What if we can stand in our own generation and have the effect of the past not be a precursor for the future? It's a possibility for David's kids. But starting with Ammon, they fall victim to the stamp on their DNA of trauma. Let's go through our passage this morning in depth. Let's look again in chapter 13, bouncing around between verses 1 through 23. We're told right off the bat that Ammon falls in love with his sister Tamar. Tamar is his half-sister, but she is still his sister. They share a father in David, but they do not share a mother. Now, we're told in scripture that he falls in love with her, but we know by his actions, this isn't love. This is some kind of all-consuming lust that turns every single one of Ammon's needs into just focus on Ammon. And by the way, when you translate this from Hebrew to English, the Hebrew says the exact same thing. It uses the word yahab, which means love, but it also means sexual feelings, which is what it translates to in here. And it's in the call participle. You've heard me talk about participles enough to know that it is one characterized by, or one defined as, the definition of the word. So Ammon is characterized by, he is defined by, his lust for Tamar. Tamar, by the way, in Hebrew means blameless, and she is. In the environment section of what we put ourselves in or surround ourselves with, it is incredibly important to put people in our lives that are going to hold us accountable and to hold us up. Look at Jehonadab. This is his friend. So So Ammon confesses his feelings for his sister Tamar, and he calls her, look at verse 4, he calls her in the latter part of verse 4, the sister of Absalom. What is he doing? It is Absalom's full sister, but it's Amnon's half-sister. He's beginning to justify in his mind why sin is okay. She's Absalom's sister. She's not mine. But the biblical law, the Levitical law, says that it is wrong for any relationship between a sister, half full or step. Now, you would think in the environment section of who we place in our life that Jonadab would have called him on this. And at the very least said, Ammon, this plan is not good. I mean, you remember what your dad did, and it wasn't even as bad as this. This is not good. It sounds like if Jonadab were a godly man and a good friend, he would have said to Ammon, sounds like you're trying to justify really, really bad behavior. But he doesn't. Jonadab and Ammon concoct a plan to lure Tamar in through King David. King David is completely oblivious to the affections that Amnon has. And so Ammon convinces his father that he's feigned illness. He's sick and he's on his deathbed and he needs his beloved sister to come and feed him. And David acquiesces, Tamar comes in, and Amnon violates her. And then, we're told, very quickly, this love he had for her turns to hate. Look at verse 15. It says, then Ammon hated her with intense hate. Sinah hagudala mohad. His hate was greatly. He had this intense hate for her. All of a sudden, he completely flips the script and he goes from loving this person, being obsessed with this person, having intense lust for this person, to immediately having this over-the-top reaction to her, and he hates her. Why? Same reason that David had an over-the-top reaction to the story about the guy with the sheep last week. Because his very bones are betraying him. Amnon knows that what he has done is wrong. He is standing in light of his sin. And when we stand in light of our own sin, it is so awful, it is so distasteful, that it turns on ourselves and we betray ourselves. It doesn't matter what we tell ourselves to kind of shove it down. His bones are betraying him. And so he has this over-the-top reaction to somebody that he has just hurt. Just as temptation, I said last week, downplays the consequences of sin, our shame and our guilt can very easily downplay the effects of our sin. We don't want to stand in the light of what it means to do something really, really, really bad. And so with that little protective M&M candy coating covering we put on our brain that tells us it really isn't that bad and you really didn't hurt anybody and no one's going to benefit from this but you, or that it's really not that big of a deal if nobody benefits from it, we lie to ourselves. And I've heard people do this. And oftentimes the way that we'll lie to ourselves the greatest is we'll say, it's just who I am. You know? My dad did it. This is just all I know. David would have told the stories of David and Bathsheba, so Amnon would have heard them. Amnon would have known about David and Bathsheba. He would have been known about that child that died. He would have known because during that 3-year period of repentance, all of those psalms that David wrote, he sang publicly. Amnon would have heard Psalm 51, which we'll say in just a little bit. He would have heard the sin and the repentance and the guilt and the shame that David felt. There is no excuse for sin. No matter what has happened in our childhood, no matter what has happened in our adulthood, there is no excuse for sin. But as Amnon stands there in light of his own sin, he hates himself so much. And you can't throw yourself out, so he throws her out. He throws Tamar out and he locks the door. And he has the intense hate for her. He treats her like some animal or some disposable item. He projects onto her the hate that he feels for himself. 100% of the time, the way that we project onto other people is how we feel about ourselves. So the humiliation that he feels, he humiliates her. The hate he feels for himself, he puts onto her. He locks her out, he violates her, and then he treats her as if she's trash, and he stands there in the light of day. Now, here's the part in the sermon where we say things like, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Or, I mean, what do you expect? It's David's kid, and look what David did. And in the second generation, it's gotta be significantly worse than the first generation. He can't help it. This is in his DNA to sin like this, right? No, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. Scripture doesn't say that. I believe that there is hope. There is always hope, and we do not have to make the same mistakes. And that same story of hunger winter is the same story that shows us we don't have to make the mistakes that are imprinted on our genes. After hunger winter and the imprint on the genes affected the second generation and the third generation, scientists began to study that group of individuals, the children and the grandchildren. And out of that corpus of work has come this research known as epigenetics. Now, epigenetics is incredibly controversial because it essentially says that we have the ability to have the environment impact our genes. In hunger winter, the negative impacted the gene adversely. But epigenetics says, what if the environment is positive? Can it then flip the gene in a positive way? So for those who have BRCA gene in their family and they live with an 80% chance of getting breast cancer, epigenetics begins to say what kind of influences we have upon our genes maybe means that that is not a foregone conclusion. Now again, it's incredibly controversial because it's not unilateral in all gene expression. But the research is amazing. They've shown that genes can turn off in one of two ways. Sometimes a new molecular stamp is stamped upon the gene, kind of like a DNA cancellation sign for whatever gene is adverse. Similar to what happened in hunger winter, but to the positive. Another way is that it's not just a stamp that gets put upon your gene, but sometimes it's stamped upon the proteins called histones. The histones are the packaging material for our genes. And sometimes an on and off switch act on those regulatory proteins and tell the gene to cancel out. This is huge. Imagine if just because something is imprinted on your genes, there's an ability to have an environmental impact that would put you in another direction. Apply that to the Word of God. What if Amnon had that? What if Amnon had had a million little things in his life that had helped him pull from one direction to another direction? A million little environmental factors that drew him closer to God instead of further away. Amnon has the same condition his father does. He wants to fill that hole that he has with lust and with entitlement, but we know that David has repented and changed, and so what if that could have been a lesson for Amnon? That the desire for lust and entitlement didn't mean that it had to be a foregone conclusion to fall into sin. What if we can change by choice what we do in our future? That our history does not have to determine where we go. For any of you who have ever seen me eat, you know that I live out a scientific experiment of epigenetics every day of my life. I know. I get made fun of all the time. And many of you know the story why. Every single adult in my family has type 2 diabetes. Adult onset type 2 diabetes. Both my biological parents got it when they were my age. I have an older brother who is a year older than Mitch, who at the age of 30, he's now 46, at the age of 30 was found unconscious in a diabetic coma. Never knew he had diabetes. And so he lives every single day with insulin. I have paternal grandparents, paternal and maternal grandparents, cousins and aunts, and uncles, all with type 2 diabetes, adult onset. In fact, my uncle, who died of the complications from type 2, lost his leg before that and was wheelchair bound the latter part of his life. So when I got gestational diabetes with our fourth child, I was told at the age of 36, it was a foregone conclusion, I would have type 2 diabetes. The family history and my age meant that it was a given. Now, with Rainin, I didn't have to take insulin. I modified my diet, and with exercise, I was able to keep my blood sugar intact through that pregnancy. But I was warned, don't ever have any more kids. Because if you do, not only will you have gestational diabetes, but you will definitely have type 2 diabetes, and the child might have diabetes. Well, again, most of you know this story. We did have another child, and I changed between our fourth and our fifth child. I changed my entire world. I changed the way that I ate. I changed the way that I exercised. I changed the way that I thought. And I cannot tell you, when I got pregnant with Tobin, I cannot tell you, our fifth child, how many people told me, you will get it, and now you will take insulin. You will get it. Endocrinologists told me, you have the trifecta effect of your age. I was 38. You have precondition of diabetes, gestational, and you have a family history. Three-hour gestational diabetes glucose test with Tobin, and I never had it. I never had it. And I've had people say to me over the years, it's great what you eat. If you've seen what I eat green for everything. I drink what looks like swamp water. We grow wheatgrass in our house that Caden juices every single day. I exercise almost every day, whether I want to or not. And the goal for me is not to be a stick. The goal is to evade my genetic stamp. And I've had doctors say to me, it's great what you eat, it's great what you do, but this is stamped in your genetic code. Yeah, it is. It is. And I could easily throw my hands up in the air and say, it's a no-brainer, I'm gonna get it. Or I can fight like mad to put in my body and around my body the ability to write above the line of my genes a new genetic code. And right now, I don't have it. I don't even have pre-diabetes. It is possible. For Amnon, he doesn't think it's possible. Amnon is a no-brainer. He falls exactly into the line of his father. And when Tamar goes to Absalom, her other brother, she is a mess. Absalom sees this woman who has taken off her ornamental robes of virginity, and she's put ash on her head, and she is struggling, and she, in every sense of the word, Amnon has killed her. She cannot marry. She is violated for the rest of her life. Absalom takes her into his home, and he takes care of her, but he hates Amnon. And what does David do? Look at verse 21. When King David heard all this, he was furious. That word furious is the same word, anger, in Hebrew that we heard last week for David when he hears about that sheep. You know, it's the idea of your nostrils flaring or that cartoon character bull with the steam coming out of its ears. He is furious. But what's also interesting about this is that the heard, shemot, is past tense, called perfect, but the angry is imperfect. Imperfect in Hebrew means present or future action. What it's telling us is he's so angry, it has no end in the immediate future. He's that angry. What does he do? And he was angry. That's it. The Septuagint, which is the Old Testament translated into Greek, from Hebrew to Greek, adds this line. It says, but David loved Amnon and didn't want to grieve his soul because he was his firstborn. He did nothing. Whether the Septuagint is correct and it was added or misread, or whether this Hebrew is correct and it wasn't there, doesn't really matter. We know that he doesn't do anything. He does nothing. He's the king. He has the ability to stop him in his tracks. He could punish Amnon. He could take away his money. He could take away his land, his titles. He could put him in jail. He could have him flogged. He could have him killed. And he does nothing. And in doing nothing, not only does he not prevent this from happening in the future, but he doesn't punish him for what has happened in the past. He does nothing. Let me stop for a moment and push this point on our parents. We have no definitive reason as to why he does nothing. But let's add some eisegesis. That means let's make some inference into the text. If I had my guess, I would say he does nothing because David has sinned and he probably feels like, who am I to say anything to my son when I've done this before? Not as bad, but I've sinned, right? I can't tell you how many parents I've heard say that to me over the years. Stephanie, I've messed up. Who am I to say anything to my kids? Who are you? You're the parent. You have every reason to say something to your kids. Never should we ever feel like we have to be hypocrites to tell our children, I messed up. Yes, David would not be a hypocrite to say to Ammon, Ammon, this way leads to death. I know it because I lost a son. I destroyed a family. That doesn't make you a hypocrite. That makes you a parent. And the enemy so easily fills us with this fear. I can't tell them what I've done because they'll think I'm a hypocrite. Do not ever give up your power. That is how sin goes into the next generation. David can stand before Ammon and say, I messed up and you messed up. I was punished and you need to get punished, but he doesn't. And what happens? It simmers for 2 years, and then Absalom takes revenge. And in one single blow, it is repeated. Sin, lust, greed, murder, and death. All over again. But it didn't have to be that way. Amnon made a choice. David made a choice. Absalom made a choice. Sin is a choice. If you're sitting here today and you live in the consequences of your parents or your grandparents, or maybe you live in the fear of repeating the same mistakes, we don't have to. If our parents used alcohol as a coping mechanism, doesn't mean we have to use it. If our parents flew off the handle and got angry at every time they were stressed out, it doesn't mean that we have to. We can write a new code. We can say, this generation will be different. Today is a choice. Go back to me and diabetes very quickly. It's not just your environment that has to change. It's actually your brain that has to change. You know, I realized this week, I was thinking about this and praying through the sermon. I don't crave sugar. 6 years I've been living like this, and I don't crave sugar. I don't walk by somebody and want to tackle them if they're eating an ice cream cone. I don't ban cookies from our house. I mean, our children will tell you, I don't allow a lot. But I don't have this feeling that I walk inside myself and feel deprived and feel like, oh my goodness, this is the worst thing in the world. It doesn't mean that the temptation to eat burgers and fries isn't there over wheatgrass and chicken, but something in me has changed. The way that I look at it has changed. And I don't say to myself, I want it, but I can't have it. I say to myself, I can have it. I don't want it. That's the way we need to look at sin. I know that I can do it, but I don't want it. Amnon would have had that desire taken from him if he had given it to God. It does not have to go into the next generation. Let's pray. Gracious Almighty God, as we go into a time of confession, speak to our hearts, illuminate for us, Father, your will, we pray. Amen. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you. Let's pray. Gracious and almighty God, you know our needs. You know where we are in our lives. You know our hearts and our minds. You know the innermost of our being. So, Father, today we come before you as new creations in Jesus Christ. Give us the will and the desire to change, Father. And if we have made that change, give us the ability to testify to others that it is possible, not out of pride, but out of hope. We ask these things in your name as we pray the prayer you've taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God is slow to anger and full of compassion. He forgives all who humbly repent and trust in his Son as Savior and Lord. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus.
Please turn your hymn books and we'll close the service with singing hymn number 468, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is.
Gracious Lord, take now into your world, we pray. Remind us as your children to be peacemakers, to be filled with grace and love, we pray. Amen.